specifically as well, just to please the family members, or just to please the relatives or friends, or just to gain more name or more fame, etc. So if one is receiving this kind of repertoire, then although one can receive, but it's not a genuine repertoire. So genuine repertoire means to receive the repertoire which is motivated by the thought of renunciation towards the whole samsara. For example, Lord Buddha has given all these precious and profound teachings to the followers in order to lead them from the ocean of samsara, in order to liberate them from the ocean of samsara. Buddha has never taught a single word of Dharma to sentient beings for them to stay in the samsara. Buddha's wish of giving all this Dharma teaching is to liberate them from the samsara, not to remain them in the samsara. So Buddha's wish is to gain liberation from the samsara, and if we as the followers, if we practice Dharma, not to gain liberation from the samsara, but to gain long life in this life, or some fame or power, or to get a good career, or if we are using Dharma to fulfill our mundane wishes, or to fulfill the wishes of this life, then it means we are practicing Dharma, or we are using the Dharma in the wrong way. Buddha gave this Dharma teaching for us to gain liberation from the samsara, to go out of the samsara. And if we are using this Dharma to stay in the samsara, then it's different. There's big difference. Staying in the samsara and going out of the samsara is two opposite to each other. Buddha's intention, Buddha's wish is to get out of it, get out of the samsara. And our intention to use Dharma or practice Dharma is to stay in the samsara, then it is not right. In the teaching itself, it says Dharma is not a method that we can use or we should use just for this life alone, or just to gain some worldly results in the samsara. So actually it is too good to use Dharma for just this life, or just for this life, or just to gain higher rebirth, or just to gain some minor results in this samsara. For example, if we make a golden dustbin, and if you put garbage in the dustbin that is made out of gold, then this gold, it is too good to put garbage in such golden dustbin. It is not worth it, because the container or the dustbin is too good to put garbage. So just like this, it is too good to use Buddha's teaching just for this life, just to get job or pass exam or to get visa or to fulfill mundane wishes of this life. It is too good to use Buddha Dharma for these minor purposes. So therefore, first, whenever we practice, it is very important to develop the thought of renunciation. Actually, if you don't have the thought of renunciation, if you don't want to go out of the samsara, if you want to stay in the samsara, then it means our wish and Buddha's purpose of giving all these teachings are not matching. It's a different direction, different purpose. So if you are doing Dharma practice which is against Buddha's wish, then it's not possible to have a good result from the practice of Dharma. If we need a great result from the practice of Dharma, then we must follow the Buddha's wish. We must follow the Buddha's teaching. We must follow the Buddha's advice. We must follow the Buddha's guidance. If we are doing something that is against Buddha's wish, then it is not a Buddha Dharma. It's not a Dharma practice. It is not possible to practice Dharma which is against Buddha's wish. If we are practicing Buddha Dharma, then definitely we should follow the Buddha's teaching, Buddha's advice, Buddha's guidance. So, whenever we study, contemplate, or meditate, or practice Dharma, first and foremost, we should have this thought of renunciation. Thought of renunciation means wish to gain liberation from the whole samsara, because the whole samsara is in the nature of suffering. For example, in this world, there are many, many different places, many different countries. Some are more developed, some are less developed. So, a person from a backward country, if they moved into a developed country, then although they can overcome some problems that they have when they are in the backward country, like bad road or no electricity or not good water, not good house, etc. These problems can be overcome when they move to a developed country. But it does not mean that they will have a great happiness when they move into a developed country. Although they don't have problems with water or electricity or road, etc., but they have many other problems. They have lots of stress, mental stress, and also many other problems. And also, of course, wherever they go, they will have sickness. Everywhere, sickness is everywhere. So, to overcome the suffering, to overcome the problem, just changing the place where you are staying is not enough. The main method to overcome the problem is not just to change our residence or just changing the place where we are going to live. What we need to change is not just our place where we are going to stay, but we need to change our mental attitude. If we change the mental attitude, then wherever you go, you will feel happy. Your mind will be in a peaceful state all the time. Your mind will not be disturbed by any external circumstances. So it is much more important to change our mind rather than physical place where we are going to live. In the developed countries also, as we can see, there are lots of problems, lots of sufferings. lots of mental anxiety and stress and worries, and also there are many who commit suicide in the developed countries also, and also some people cannot sleep in these developed countries, so they need to take sleeping pills to sleep. So it means, or it clearly indicates, that material development alone will not give you the genuine peace or genuine happiness. So therefore, the real peace should come from the mind, not just from the external factors, or not just from the material development. In the last several decades, or since I was born, there has been lots of material developments. But it doesn't mean that nowadays people are much happier than 40, 50 years ago. So it clearly shows material development alone will not help you to gain the genuine happiness. So therefore, we should have the positive mind, we should have the positive thought. And to have positive thought, first we need to develop the thought renunciation towards the wholesome thought, which means thinking the whole samsara is in the nature of suffering. Wherever we go, we will not be free from suffering. For example, in this world, there's not a single person who has never experienced any suffering. There's not a single place in this world where there's no suffering. Wherever we go in this world, we won't be free from suffering. So it's not a matter of place where we go. It's a matter of mind. If the mind is in a peaceful state, then wherever we go, we will feel happy and joy. So just like the whole world is in the nature of suffering, similarly the whole samsara is in the nature of suffering. So therefore, we should not have strong attachment to samsara. So we need this life. This life is precious. This life is very precious. But at the same time, we should not have attachment to this life. But we should take care of this life. We should look after this life. And we should use this life in a proper way without having attachment. I normally say, this life is like a paper cup. We use the paper cup. Before using the paper cup, we will keep it. We will keep, and then we will use the paper cup. And after using it, we will throw it without having any attachments. We don't feel stingy when we throw it after using it. So similarly, this life is something that we need to use in a proper way. So when we use, we need to keep it. We need to keep and use. And after using it, we need to throw, which means we need to dispose this body. We can't keep this body for centuries and centuries. After 60, 70, 80, 90 years, then we need to dispose this body. We need to throw this, or we need to dispose this life, or this present life or present body. We can't keep, no one can keep this present body for centuries and centuries. Maximum is over 100 years, not 200 or 300 years. So we need to throw this body, which has been with us, with this soul or with this mind for the whole life, but at the end we need to throw. So at that time we should not have attachment, we should not have fear, we should not have any attachment. So when we have this body, this present body, we must use it in a good way. We should use this to help others. We should use this body or life to serve other sentient beings. So we can be happy and we can make others happy. So this life can be used in a good way, in a meaningful way, in a purposeful way. So then it means we have used this life in a very meaningful way. So therefore, when we have this life, we should have good practice. We should use this in a proper way by practicing Dharma or by doing good things, by doing good actions or positive actions. So to do a positive actions, we need to develop the thought renunciation towards the whole samsara, and then to develop the loving kindness and compassion to all the sentient beings. As I said before, whether we can develop the genuine loving kindness and compassion or not depends on our object of loving kindness and compassion. If our object is limited, then no matter how much effort that we put to practice loving kindness and compassion, still we will not be able to practice the genuine loving kindness and compassion because object is limited. So therefore, first we should have the right object to whom we are going to practice loving kindness and compassion. So sentient beings are not the obstacle of our loving kindness and compassion. They are object of loving kindness and compassion. They are part of our practice of loving kindness and compassion. So, as I said before, object means all the sentient beings, and all the sentient beings means not only the more than 7 billion people of this world, and also not only all the animals of this world, but all the sentient beings of the six realms are object of our loving kindness and compassion. So if we know this, if we can identify this object, if we can recognize this object, then based on this object, or by focusing on this object, we should develop the loving kindness and compassion. By thinking, may all the sentient beings gain happiness and gain the cause of happiness, which is to engage in the virtuous deeds or positive actions. And then compassion means may all these sentient beings be free from the suffering, all kinds of suffering, and be free from cause of suffering, which means be free from engaging in the negative actions or non-virtuous deeds. So we should practice this. Actually, just having the intellectual understanding on this loving kindness and compassion is not enough. After having the intellectual understanding, then we need to apply these thoughts into action. If we can't apply this, if we can't put it into action, then it's not much useful, or it won't make great impact on our mind. So we need to be practical. We need to practice loving kindness and compassion in our daily life. Then that can suppress or that can control our negative emotions or mental afflictions. And if our mind is positive, then it means out of this positive mind, we can do our positive actions through our body and speech. And if all our actions are positive, then there's no chance for us to experience suffering in the future, because there's no cause. There will be no suffering without cause. All the suffering has its own cause, its own karma, its own bad karma in the past. So, generally speaking, we should practice total renunciation, loving kindness, and compassion to all. And then we should develop the bodhicitta, wishing bodhicitta, and engage in bodhicitta. For like today, for the sake of all the sentient beings, we wish to gain Buddhahood, and for that purpose, we are receiving this refuge vow, bodhicitta vow, and initiation, etc. Generally speaking, every day in the morning, first thing you should develop total renunciation, loving kindness, compassion, and bodhicitta. At that time, one can think that, or you can think that, for the sake of all the sentient beings, you wish to gain Buddhahood, and for that purpose, may all your today's activities be the cause of attaining the Buddhahood, etc. Yeah, like that. So anyway, with the right motivation, which means total renunciation, loving kindness, compassion, and wishing and engaging bodhicitta. So with this in mind, now you should receive the refuge and bodhicitta vow. First, we should contemplate on the cause of refuge, which means, as I've explained before, there are three kinds of cause: fear, faith, and compassion. Fear means fear of experiencing the suffering of samsara, and fear of having the selfish thought or self-judging thought, which is the root of all the sufferings of the samsara. And then faith means the unshakable faith, the unconditional faith towards the Guru and Triple Gem. And which can be divided into three: clear faith, desiring faith, and believing faith. And then third cause is compassion, the great compassion. So just by having the great compassion, or just by having the mere compassion thought, is not enough to liberate all the beings from the samsara. So based on this compassion, or the great compassion, then we need to take refuge in the Buddha Dhamma and Sangha. So these three, fear, faith, and compassion, are the cause of taking refuge in the Triple Gem or Buddha Dhamma and Sangha. So these are the three cause. And then the second, the object of taking refuge is Buddha Dhamma and Sangha. Generally speaking, there are three Buddha Dhamma and Sangha, but in the Vajrayana there are four: Guru, Buddha, Dhamma, and Sangha. So anyway, Buddha means a perfect being, a being who has been free from all the obscurations, all the sufferings and problems, and the being who possess all the ultimate qualities, like ultimate knowledge, ultimate wisdom, ultimate compassion, ultimate loving kindness, ultimate power, ultimate happiness, ultimate joy, etc. And once Buddha has obtained all these, then it will never change. It will always remain like this forever. And then Dharma means method. Dharma is like a medicine. Medicine is a method to cure our sickness and to give us a healthy and strong body. Similarly, Dharma can cure. Dharma is a method that can cure the sickness of our mental afflictions and that can give us very healthy or very happy state or ultimate state, ultimate happiness, state of ultimate happiness can be gained through the practice of Dharma, through using this method. And generally speaking, there are two kinds, teaching and realization, as I have explained it before. Then third one is how to visualize, how to take refuge. So today in front of you, you should visualize as a jewel throne lifted by two lines, each from the four directions. So total eight lines are lofting the jewel throne, and on the throne there is a full moon disc. There's a lotus and full moon disc, lotus flower and full moon disc, and on that you should visualize there's a Buddha Shakyamuni. So just now you should visualize this Buddha Shakyamuni in the nature of light, the real one, not just an imagination, but the real one in the nature of light. And behind Buddha Shakyamuni, you should visualize the pile of Dharma books. And Buddha is surrounded by all the noble bodhisattvas like Manjushri, Avalokiteshvara, Vajrapani, and others. And all these objects are called the refuge field. This is the object to whom we are going to take refuge. And this refuge field is in the nature of light, just like a rainbow. We can see the colors of the rainbow very clearly, yet we can't touch by our own hands. Similarly, we can visualize this refuge field in a three-dimensional form, a real one in the nature of light, but at the same time, it is devoid of self-nature. It is devoid of truly existence. It is in the nature of light, like a rainbow or like a reflection in the mirror. So after visualizing the object of refuge or the refuge field, then we should take refuge. And when we take refuge in the guru, actually guru is the combination of all the triple gem or all the refuge. So when we take refuge in the guru, we should focus on Buddha Shakyamuni's wisdom and think that this is the, our guide. Focus on guru, focus on, when we take refuge in the guru, we focus on the Buddha Shakyamuni's wisdom and think that this is our guide. And when we take refuge in the Buddha, we focus on Buddha Shakyamuni and think that this is the one who shows us the path. And when we take refuge in the Dharma, we focus on the pile of Dharma books and think that this is the actual path. And when we take refuge in the noble assembly or noble sangha, at that time we should focus on the noble bodhisattvas who are surrounding the Buddha Shakyamuni and think that these are our spiritual companions. So with such in mind, then we take refuge, or we recite refuge prayers as much as we can. Normally, our Guru, His Holiness, the 41st Sakya Tenzin or Karma Tenzin Lama, always say, whenever we do prayers, whenever we do recitations, the quality is more important than the quantity. Even do refuge prayers like 100,000 times without visualization, then it won't have a strong impact. It won't yield a very great result. But if you do the recitations with a visualization, then it's more effective. It is more meaningful and it has much greater result.